time. You know, I just love the Sabbath. Anybody here with me on that? I just love this day. I love the fact that we can gather together and have this peace and this fellowship. For me, the Sabbath is such a rejuvenating day. And you know, you all make it that way for me. The encouragements, the conversations. And I hope that we don't ever forget the blessings we have for being able to assemble. God's really smart. He knows this is a good day for us to be together. So, you know, it's really great to see you. I want to say hello to all those who are tuning in today out there on the webcast that are watching. We say happy Sabbath to you, and we're so glad that you're with us. We're glad for the webcast because the webcast is set up for those who are shut in. Maybe weather has got them, got them where they can't travel. There are those of you who are able to watch in the morning on the webcast and then go to afternoon services. So we just welcome all of you to God's Sabbath today. And thank you that you can join us. We can all be together, one big happy family today. I wanted to read the last line of O Worship the King, because this is, I think I lean on this, and I think we all do, where it's the last, verse 4 says, "Frail children of dust and feeble as frail." I represent that, Maria Mark. "Thee do we trust, nor find you to fail." And that, boy, isn't that true. God will never let us down. We trust in Him. "Thy mercies, how tender, how firm to the end, our maker, defender, redeemer, and friend." That basically says it all. I don't need to give a sermon. I'm going to sit down. I would like to talk about a topic today. And with that last verse, that is kind of the framework of what I want to discuss, and that is that God is the one that takes care of us. And He is the one that watches over us. And he does like to see some things from us. Today I want to talk about the subject and ask you, are you a person of courage? A person of courage. We're going to look at some scriptures, basically a story that talks about courage, because God wants us to be courageous. He wants us to be courageous Christians. And even though we are frail children and we need Him and we trust in Him in all things, and His mercies are what get us through, He does want us to be courageous. And we want to find out what that is and find out if we are what He wants us to be in that way. To begin with, let's go over here to 1 Corinthians chapter 10 to get the background of what we're going. We're going to look at a story in the Old Testament. And all of the lessons that we can learn and all of the things that are written there are for us. And we read this in chapter 10 of 1 Corinthians. And verse 6 says, "Now these things were our examples." You know, talks about the things that they're examples for us to learn, how not to do and how to do. Verse 11 says, "Now all these things happen unto them for examples, and they are written for," notice there's a couple of things I just point out, they're written for our admonition. And I hope when we study the Old Testament, when we study God's Word, that we look at it and learn lessons from it. I mean, really, when we read the Bible, don't we all read the Bible and say, "I'm looking at this from a perspective of how am I doing in reference to the lessons and the things being taught?" Aren't we all introspective that way? I think we are. I hope we are. But it says, "All these things happen to them for examples. They're written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the earth have come." So they're examples. And they're, you know, in the Old Testament, are there just good examples? Or should I say, are there just bad examples in the Old Testament? No, I mean, there's some great examples. And there's examples that are of, you know, disobedience and things that we learn from. And we're supposed to learn how to respond to those things. And they're written for us. You know, they're gentle reminders, they're reproof, they're caution, they are directionary for us, give us a path, because we need inspiration, and we need to be able to, I tell you, I look at the Old Testament and the Old Testament stories, and I gain inspiration from it because of those faithful that lead us, and one of those we want to talk about today. You know, the one thing that I would hate, personally, just thinking about standing let's say we know that some of these stories that are written, you know, I don't want any bad stories written about me published so everybody sees them. Is anybody with me on that? I want good stories written. But you know, sometimes though, they can be very good teaching tools when bad things are written. And so, but none of us really want bad things written about us. We all want to be the positive, and I hope that that we will endeavor to be those good examples. I think Christians see the word courage, and think about this, as being used when someone takes a stance for biblical principles. I think that would be fair, wouldn't you? That's courageous when Christians take a stand for biblical principles, absolutely. And certainly it makes it important for us to understand what the Bible defines as courage. And there are interesting things. In the Bible, for example, courage is also called good cheer. And in Mark 6:50, I'm not going to turn there. This is where Jesus is walking on the water. They're in the Sea of Galilee. And the disciples see him, and they get all scared because they see somebody walking on water thinking it's a ghost or an apparition or something like that. And he, what does he say to him? He says, "Be of good cheer. It's me. Be of good cheer." And those words, coming, the Greek word translated courage and good cheer literally means boldness and confidence. He's saying to them, just, it's okay. Be bold, be confident, it's me. And in the Bible, see if you think this is fair too, when we're talking about courage and to be of good cheer and to have courage, he seems to use that in commanding against something. What would that be? Fear. Commanding against fear, which is opposite of courage. If you want to know what the opposite of courage is, it's fear. Fear is our enemy. I don't like it when I'm fearful. I don't like it when I'm in moments of fear. And I have them. Do you? They don't last very long because I really understand and comprehend that God is there for us and we should have courage and confidence in that. But God doesn't simply command us to have courage with no reason. No reason behind it. In nearly every incident, when God says, "Be of good courage, fear not," there follows a reason to have courage. And I believe that reason is God Himself. He is the reason we can have courage. Yep. And His nature and His perfect plans, we can be confident, courageous, and of good cheer because of Him. Because of what He writes, we can have confidence in this. Because of the plans that He has for us, we can have confidence in that. And because of the future that we have, we can have confidence. So I want us to go look at a story in the Old Testament, and it's one that you're very familiar with. And because it is, we find in this story a stark contrast between fear, timidity, as opposed to confident and courageous and wholeheartedness and boldness. So turn with me, if you would. It's a story about men we need to be like and men we don't need to be like. But turn with me over here to the book of Leviticus, or Numbers. Let's go over here to the book of Numbers and go to chapter 13, Numbers chapter 13. And today we're going to look and we're going to read about the story of the 12 spies. And I know we're... anybody read this story recently? Okay. If everybody would, I would just sit down because... But this is really a fascinating story about the 12 that were sent out. And I would like... what I'd like to do is I'm going to be reading quite a bit of the portions of chapter 13 and 14 so that we get a feel and a flow of what is taking place. And then we're going to see the outstanding characteristics of two guys, two men of God, Joshua and Caleb, and how they stood out. And they are men that you and I can follow. They are men whom we can learn lessons of courage and how they were able to do that. Beginning here in Numbers chapter 13, let's just begin here in verse 17. It says, "And Moses sent them to spy out the land." And preceding that, you know, beginning in verse 4 through verse 15, you read of the 12. It's a list of the 12 that were sent out. And we know that there was one sent from each tribe sent out to spy the land. And Moses, verse 17, sent them to spy out the land of Canaan and said unto them, "Get you up this way southward and go up into the mountains, to the mountain, and see the land, what it is, and the people that dwell there, and whether they be strong or weak, few or many." You know, this was a trek and an expedition, an excursion to check it out, check out the land. And how long were they gone? Remember? 40 days. And what the land, verse 19, "And what the land is that they dwell in, whether it be good or bad, and what cities they be that dwell therein, whether in tents or in strongholds." So, you know, they're gathering, this is an information gathering trip. They're going to gather information and bring it back and share it so that they know. Now, I stop and think about this. Did they really need to go and do this? Did they really need to? And that's a good topic of discussion. But just think about that. Did they need to go? I mean, we're to go out and spy and see all that, is that really trusting in God? You know, so just throw that out there. And verse 20, "And see what the land is, whether it be fat or lean, whether there be wood therein or not. And be you of good courage." Notice that. "Be you of good courage and bring of the fruit of the land." Because now the time was the time of the first ripe grapes. So there you have it. We know what time of the year it was then. "So they went up and searched the land from the wilderness of Zin unto Rehob, as men had come to Hamath. And they ascended by the south and came unto Hebron, where Ahiman, Sheshai, and Talmai, the children of Anak, were." Now Hebron was built 7 years before Zoan in Egypt. "And they came unto the brook of Eshcol, and cut down from thence a branch with one cluster of grapes, and they bare it between them upon a staff." Now, I remember the old Bible story picture about that. Do you remember that? It shows, you know, the guys in that piece of wood they've got that hung on is bent because it's heavy, and those look like those grapes were as big as grapefruit. And so obviously they're bringing this back, and it's obviously a very, very rich, beautiful land. And anyway, "they bare it between them on a staff, and they brought of the pomegranates and of the figs. And the place was called the Brook of Eshcol because of the cluster of grapes, which the children of Israel cut down from thence. And they returned from searching the land after 40 days. And verse 26 says, now I say this, stop here for just a minute. The children of Israel, up to this point, had not displayed a real trust in God, had they? They've had their struggles for 40 years and rebellion and all those things. And I don't see them at this point having a lot of confidence in God leading them. And hopefully that's not something familiar to us. I hope that we are not that way. I hope we will have all confidence. And of course, that is always tested by our actions, isn't it? Our trust and confidence in God to lead us is always tested by what we do, how we respond, and what kind of courage we have for truth. Because frankly, as we read through some of these stories and the things that they faced and the things that the ten spies said, you know, in our lives, sometimes we have the children of Anak against us, you know? And sometimes we're faced up against the strong cities that seem impenetrable in our trials. You know, each of us have our challenges. Have you ever been through a difficulty or a challenge where you don't sense that there's any overcoming this, that it is a barrier I can't get through? So they returned after 40 days, verse 26, "And they went and came to Moses and Aaron and all the congregation of the children of Israel unto the wilderness of Paran, to Kadesh, and brought back word with them, and unto all the congregation, and showed them the fruit of the land." So far, so good. And they told and said, "We come into the land whither you sent us, and surely it flows with milk and honey, and this is the fruit of it." That was a good report. And then what's the next word? Nevertheless. Nevertheless, the people be strong that dwell in the land, and the cities are walled and very great. And moreover, we saw the children of Anak there. And the Amalekites dwell in the land of the south, and the Hittites and the Jebusites and the Amorites dwell in the mountains, and the Canaanites dwell by the sea and by the coast of Jordan. And Caleb stilled the people before Moses and said these words, "Let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it." Now, is that amazing, the contrast of vision there? There is one of fearful, there's giants, you know, we're scared of these guys in walled cities, and you know, they're too strong for us, we can't do it. And what does Caleb say? "Let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it." What's the difference? What is the difference? Why the difference in there? Because, you know, Caleb, he encourages people to go on. And I'm going to paraphrase what I would think he's thinking in his mind. So forgive me, this is Wynn saying this. This is what I perceive Caleb to be saying, that he encourages the people to go on. He speaks as one resolved to lead them with bravery. "Let us go up at once. One bold step, one bold stroke more. We'll do our business. It is all our own if we have but courage to make it so. Let us go up and possess it." In his mind, there is nothing to be done but enter and take the possession which God, our great God, is ready to give us. I kind of think that's where his mindset. It may not have been exactly that way, but I do know that Caleb had been paying attention. He knew they had something that nobody else had. They had the ace in the hole. They had God. They had God, and he was leading them. And he knew God was really with them, and he knew God was on their side. How did he know? As I say, I believe he'd been paying attention. Had he not seen all the miracles? Yes, he had. And he had seen the miracles God performed extracting the children of Israel out of Egypt. He saw those things. He was involved with it. He and Joshua both, when they came up. He was confident and willing to trust God. I believe that's most important. He was confident and willing to trust God. And it showed in his words. He was ready to go. And he had total trust in God and total trust, willing to follow God and what God wanted done. And I am convinced that he and Joshua were of the same mindset. They were brothers. You know, they were brothers together. Yes. They had heard these words that I want us to turn to Deuteronomy chapter 31. Keep your place here because we're going to come back. They had heard words like this spoken, which Joshua heard in later days as well. But they heard and understood this from God. Verse 6 of Deuteronomy 31. "Be strong and of good courage, fear not, nor be afraid of them. For the Lord your God, He it is that does go with you. He will not fail you, nor forsake you." And Moses called unto Joshua and said unto him in the sight of all of Israel, "Be strong and of good courage, for you must go with this people unto the land which the Eternal has sworn unto their fathers to give them, and you shall cause them to inherit it. And the Eternal, He it is that does go before you. He will be with you, He will not fail you, neither forsake you. Fear not, neither be dismayed." Do you think Caleb believed that? He saw that. He understood that. And he was one who was strong and of good courage. But let's continue reading. Verse 31, back to Numbers chapter 13. "But the men that went up with him said, 'We are not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we.' And they brought up an evil report of the land which they had searched unto the children of Israel, saying, 'The land through which we have gone to search it is a land that eats up the inhabitants thereof. And all the people we saw in it are men of great stature. And frankly, in these next few verses, what we're reading here, their response, their understanding, the way they communicated this, the way they caused the children of Israel to doubt, frankly changed the course of a whole nation of people. At least those who were over 20 years of age. At least those who were over 20 years of age, because they did, they had this view. Where was the trust? Where was the be of good courage? Trust me, I'm with you. You know, I think about our, I think us in our spiritual walks, you know, do we ever get to the point where it's like we're fearful and, you know, we can't overcome this? And have we gone to God and just acknowledged to Him, you're always with us. I know you're always with me. I need to trust you. Give me strength. Give me faith. Give me the ability. Give me the ability to trust in you and to have courage in the face of difficulty, in the face of trials, in the face of all those things that we face. Anyway, it changed the course of a whole nation. Verse 32 again, and they brought up an evil report of the land which they had searched unto the children of Israel. The land through which we had gone to search it is a land that eats up the inhabitants thereof. And all the people, that term to me means it's just huge, it's big, eats it up. It's, you know, you're swallowed up in what is there. And all the people that saw, saw in it are men of great stature. Well, I think that was an exaggeration. It does say that Anak had three sons. What they're saying here is everybody's a giant. And isn't that kind of the way it is? We tend to exaggerate things at times. And there we saw the giants and the sons of Anak, which come of the giants. And we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and we were, and so were we in their sight. That's a telltale statement. They viewed themselves as grasshoppers. Remember David when he was up against the Philistine? He didn't have fear, did he? There was a trust. There was actually a defiance against anything that would defy God. That is a boldness. What a lesson. What a lesson for us. So continuing here in chapter 14, it says, all the congregation lifted up their voice and cried, and the people wept that night because of these reports that came back. And the children of Israel murmured against Moses and against Aaron. And the whole congregation said, would God that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would God we had died in this wilderness. And wherefore has the Lord brought us into this land to fall by the sword, that our wives and our children should be prey? That's an interesting statement, by the way. Were it not better for us to return to Egypt? And they said to one another, let us make a captain and let us return to Egypt. And then Moses and Aaron did what I think all of us should have done, and I hope we all would have done. They fell on their knees to avoid getting struck by lightning, right? Moses and Aaron fell on their faces before the assembly of the congregation of the children of Israel. And Joshua, love this guy, the son of Nun, and Caleb, love this guy, the son of Jephunneh, which were of them that searched the land, rent their clothes. And they spake unto all the congregation of the children of Israel, saying, the land which we pass through to search it is an exceedingly good land. If the Lord, notice these words, because this is where they were trusting, if the Lord delight in us, then He will bring us into this land and give it to us, a land which flows with milk and honey. Only rebel not ye against the Lord, neither fear for ye the people of the land, for they are bread for us. Their defense is departed from them, and the Eternal is with us. Fear them not. So did the congregation respond to them and say, all right, yeah, we're with you? The congregation bade stone them with stones. And the glory of the Eternal appeared in the tabernacle of the congregation before all the children of Israel. And the Eternal said to Moses, how long will this people provoke me, and how long will it be ere they believe me for all the signs which I have showed unto them? You know, sometimes I wonder if God doesn't say the same thing to us. How long will they not? How long before they will believe me and know that I will do what I've said I've done? How long? I will smite them with the pestilence and disinherit them, and will make them make of you a greater nation, mightier than they. And Moses showed his humility there, didn't he, in the next few verses? Because he doesn't say, all right, God, strike them dead. Start it with me. You know, he pleads on behalf of the children of Israel. Moses said to the Eternal, if you do that, God, then the Egyptians shall hear it, for they brought you brought us this people in your might from among them, and they will tell it to the inhabitants of this land, for they have heard that you are eternal, that you eternal are among this people, that you eternal are seen face to face, and that you and that thy cloud stands over them, and that you go before them by daytime in a pillar of cloud and a pillar of fire by night. If you kill all this people as one man, then the nations which have heard of your fame will speak, saying, this is incredible logic that Moses is praying to God, talking to God about. This is it. I stopped to pause because do you think we cannot have that kind of conversations with God? We can plead on his behalf. Plead on, you know, for these things. He says, if you kill all this people as one man, then the nations which heard of your fame will speak, saying, because the Eternal was not able to bring this people into the land which he sware unto them, therefore he has slain them in the wilderness. Now I beseech you, let the power of my Lord be great, according as you have spoken, saying, the Eternal is long-suffering and of great mercy, forgiving iniquity and transgression, and by no means clearing the guilty, but visiting the iniquities of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation. Pardon, I beseech you, the iniquity of this people, according unto the greatness of your mercy, and as you have forgiven this people from Egypt even until now. And God said, I have pardoned according to your word. Moses had a lot of boldness as well and courage on behalf of the people. But as truly as I live, all the earth shall be filled with the glory of the Eternal, of the Lord. That's quite a pronouncement. That's quite a pronouncement. Because of all those men which have seen my glory and my miracles, which I did in Egypt and in the wilderness, and have tempted me now these 10 times. Really? Well, it's very interesting, because if you go back to 1 Corinthians 10, where we started there, and if you read verses 6 through 10, it lists, you know, a lot of those things. They lusted after evil things. They were idolaters. The people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. It was commanded, neither let us commit fornication, as some of them committed, and fell in one day 23,000. These are some of the times that he's talking. 10 times. God keeps score. He knows. Now, I don't know that he's keeping score, but he recognizes. He knows. And they tempted Christ, as some of them tempted and were destroyed of serpents. And then I can list the scriptures where they did things like they murmured at Marah, because of bitter waters. They murmured in the wilderness of sin, wanted to go back to Egypt. They didn't want to follow instructions on manna. And they went out and even gathered it on the Sabbath day. Or they refused to obey God. They murmured at Rephidim because of no water. They made the golden calf. Now, I think we would like to think we are better and would never do things like this in rebellion against God. But honestly, we do. Honestly, we do. And, you know, that we have to deal with that. And we have to recognize that, and we have to repent of those things. And we need to, you know, courage is a challenge. And courage is an important thing for us to be able to stand for the right things of God. They lusted for meat. They complained. They wanted a new leader. We just read that, to take them back to Egypt. And God says, surely they shall not see, verse 23, the land which I swear unto their fathers, neither shall any of them that provoke me see it. But then he says this of Caleb. He says this, verse 24, but my servant Caleb, because he had another spirit with him and has followed me fully or wholly or wholeheartedly. Courage and wholeheartedness were part of his direction. Him will I bring into the land wherein he went, where, and his seed shall possess it. Says that of him. And certainly, this is, I think, really the point. Under the influence of God's Spirit, Caleb was heroic and bold and courageous. Above worldly anxieties and fears, he was able to see through that. I think that is a real lesson for us. Can we be like that? Can we see like that? Can we have, under the influence of God's Spirit, the trust and confidence in God like he did? And there's certainly lessons to be learned. But I'll let you read some of the lessons here up through verse 39. Because we have to ask this question. Since Caleb had this spirit, another spirit, what kind of spirit do we have? What kind of spirit dwells within us? The righteous are supposed to be bold as lions. And frankly, it's supposed to be this way, that difficulties and the sin that so easily besets us and the challenges that we have are supposed to dwindle and vanish under our active live faith. It's supposed to diminish in the power of the promises of God. And frankly, all things are possible. We're told that, aren't we? All things are possible through Christ. All things are possible if they're promised to him that believes. So turn with me to Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 1. And we know this by heart, I'm sure, 2 Timothy 1:7. I'll let everybody get there. 2 Timothy 1, verse 7. What kind of spirit has God granted to us? These are the fruits or the effects of God's Holy Spirit. Verse 7 says, God has not given us the spirit of fear. Thank God. So therefore, when we are fearful, we are not exercising the right spirit, are we? We're under the influence of another spirit. Hey, we fight against, you know, we have enemies. We have a big enemy, and we wrestle. We wrestle. It says we're not to, he's not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Power means strength and might. Ability to do, ability to believe, ability to accomplish. And love is, you know, the affection, the benevolence. It is the care. It's what he is. That spirit that we have, the spirit that has that part of love. God is love. That's part of, he's granting us part of him, himself. And then, of course, a sound mind, which is self-discipline, self-control. And, hey, when we are challenged with difficulties, we have to have self-control and self-discipline to resist, right? I mean, it talks about in James about if, you know, we're tempted to sin, it becomes sin when we let our minds take it to it, but we can stop that. And that is part of what a sound mind does. Fear is the enemy. Fear is the enemy. But God has given us this great spirit of power and of love and of a sound mind. And with that, we're able to do, I believe, what is said over here in Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. One of these days, that enemy death is going to be removed. We see that in verse 55, 56. But verse 57, but thanks be to God, which gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm telling you, we don't have any victory outside of Him. We're not going to, in fact, all of our courage and trust is because He gives us that, and we trust in Him and what He's doing. That's what Caleb did. He trusted in God and what He was going to do. He believed it to the point he was ready to go battle for God. In this case, for possession of his inheritance. I think we too battle for our possession. You know, into the kingdom of God. And we're not going to get there without struggle. It's a struggle to overcome. It says, you know, in Romans that unless we suffer, unless we go through difficulties, unless we go through those things and bear up, you know, I mean, it's just that way. We have it. It's part of life and how we deal with it. We have to be courageous. We have to stand and see the salvation of God. But verse 58 says, therefore, my beloved brethren, be you steadfast and unmovable. You know, sometimes that takes courage to stand unmovable in the face of opposition and in the face of difficulties. Hey, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. I hope we recognize that. Our labor is not in vain, the work that we do towards that. And if we need strength, it says go to Him, He'll give us strength. If we need any help from God, He will give us whatever we need. He is there. Prayer is a powerful tool. It's really interesting about fear, because look at this over in Revelation chapter 21. We need to stand in courage. We need to stand in the things of God's Holy Spirit. We need to stand in strength from God, because we need to stand in the power and love and sound mind of the things that He gives us. That's the Spirit that He gives us. In Revelation 21, verse 7 says, He that overcomes shall inherit all things. I think back to Joshua and Caleb and what they were looking forward to inheriting, the promised land, what they were willing to do to receive it. The trust that they placed in God finishing that for them. Is that any different for us? Because we are going to receive something too, eternal life, inheritance. We're going to receive the promised land, the kingdom of God, to be with Him forever. He that overcomes shall inherit all things. And we inherit all things because we're heirs and joint heirs with Christ, as it says in Romans. That's why, because we are part of the family. Part of the family. And I will be his God, and he shall be my son. But notice this, verse 8. But the fearful and unbelieving, the abominable and murderers, whoremongers, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire, brimstone, which is the second death. Fearful is not good. Fear is not good. The fearful and unbelieving. I don't know, I sense that God has always put this before us. And whether we're going to believe Him and trust Him, or we're going to have those that were fearful. I think the same challenge that faced the 12 faces you and I today. It's the same challenge. The same challenge. And what will we do? How will we be? How courageous will we be? You know, I got to say a few things about Caleb. Turn with me to Joshua chapter 14. And we're going to find out... I don't sense that what we read, what we're about to read, is happened because he was genetically strong, but I don't know for sure. But Joshua chapter 14. And remember, it was Joshua who led them in. It was Joshua who appointed them their inheritances as God had spoken. And we're going to read now, beginning here in verse 6 of Joshua 14, of Caleb receiving his inheritance. And pardon me if I have a tough time getting through this. because I think this is pretty amazing. It says, then the children of Judah came unto Joshua in Gilgal, and Caleb, the son of Jephunneh the Kenizzite, said unto him, you know, so he's talking to his old buddy, Joshua. They stood together. They were there together. They came through the battles. You knew, he says, you know the thing that the Eternal said unto Moses, the man of God, concerning me. When God said, with Caleb, there's a different spirit. There's something different about him. He trusts me. Let's be those that God could say things like that about us. But notice verse 7 says, 40 years old was I when Moses, the servant of the Lord, of the Eternal, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to spy out the land. He was 40. And I brought him word again as it was in mine heart. Nevertheless, my brethren that went up with me made the heart of the people melt. But notice this, I wholly followed the Eternal my God. And Moses sware on that day, saying, the land wherein your feet have trodden shall be your inheritance, and thy children's forever, because you have wholly followed the Eternal my God. And now behold, the Eternal has kept me alive. Notice this. As he has said, these 40 and 5 years. So they were 40 years wandering. He was 40. He's 85, and he's receiving his inheritance. Notice this. These 40 and 5 years. Ever since the Eternal spake these words unto Moses, while the children of Israel wandered in the wilderness, and lo, I am this day 85 years old. As yet, I am as strong this day as I was in the day that Moses sent me. As my strength was then, even so my strength now, for war, both to go in and to come in. Go out and to come in. Now, I don't know if that's in his mind, he thinks that, or maybe he is. Maybe he has that strength. I tend to believe he did. I tend to believe that God has kept him alive, as he says there in verse 10. I believe God gave him strength. He says, now therefore give me this mountain whereof the Eternal spake that day. And he was given the inheritance of Hebron, where he spied out the land. He received his inheritance. That's very moving. It's very moving, the whole story, the faithfulness that they exhibited. And I think the end of the story for us, because we battle and we have our wars as well for the Lord. We too go through those things. I believe this, that what we read over here in Romans, the 8th chapter, please turn with me over here to Romans chapter 8. God was with them, was he not? And notice verse 31 of Romans 8. It says, what shall we say then if to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? If God be for us. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifies. Who is he that condemns? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Good question. Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? Is there anything that's going to take us away from God? I believe he's faithful. I want on his team. I want to be on his side. I want to be with him. Keep your finger here because we're going to come back here. But Joshua chapter 21, please turn with me to Joshua 21. Because through all of the trials and all of the rebellion and all of the difficulties that took place in the children of Israel coming out, we read this in Joshua 21, beginning here in verse 43, about God's faithfulness and His promise. In verse 43, talking about the inheritance, it says, "And the Lord and the Eternal gave unto Israel all the land which He sware to give unto their fathers, and they possessed it and dwelt therein." That is a simple sentence that speaks volumes to a promise fulfilled by God. Took years and decades for that to happen. Difficulties, sin, and rebellion, and yet He brought it to pass. He brought it about. "And the Eternal gave them rest round about according to all that He sware to their fathers. And there stood not a man of all their enemies before them." You know that the enemy cannot stand before God. And if we are in God's will and if we are courageous in following Him, the enemy cannot stand before us. We will have the courage to overcome. "There stood not a man of all their enemies before them. The Eternal delivered all their enemies into their hand." Do we think we can fight our battles without Him? Because really it's His battle. We just have to give it to Him and we have to trust in Him. "There," and then this is a huge verse. "There failed not aught of any good thing which the Eternal had spoken unto the house of Israel. All came to pass." God, who's faithful? God is faithful. Verse 38, back here in Romans chapter 8, Paul says, "I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." And I am convinced that He will fulfill all of the promises He has to us, just like He did for them. Just like He did for them. So let's be courageous. Let's take courage. I want to read Joshua 1, verses 1 through 9 to end. Joshua chapter 1. And it is interesting that Joshua, Jesus, would lead them into the promised land. And who leads us? So as we read this, just maybe think about, thank you, I needed that to be able to read this. Verse 1, Joshua 1. "Now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Eternal, it came to pass that the Eternal spake unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise, go over this Jordan, you and all this people, unto the land which I give to them, even to the children of Israel. Every place that the sole of your feet shall tread upon, that have I given unto you, as I spoke unto Moses. From the wilderness and this Lebanon, even into the great river, the river Euphrates, and all the land of the Hittites, and unto the great sea toward the going down of the sun, shall be your coast. There shall not any man be able to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so will I be with you. I will not fail you, and nor forsake you. Be strong and of good courage. For unto this people shall you divide for an inheritance the land which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Only be you strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded you. Turn not from it to the right nor to the left, that you may prosper whether you go. The book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate therein day and night, that you may observe to do all that is written therein. For then shall you make your way prosperous, and then shall you have good success. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be you dismayed, for the Eternal, your God, is with you wherever you go.